In this lecture, I'll be explaining what logic gates are and going through a lot of instructions that we've not seen in the past videos. So what are logic gates anyways? They're like little circuits in your computer that will always output something depending on what you provide it. They usually only take up to two inputs and are composed of three main ones. These three main ones are the AND, the NOT, and the OR. In order to create new gates, we simply combine these three together and it creates new ones. One example of this combination is if you take a NOT and an OR, it creates an OR. But now, what do these logic gates do exactly? What do they output when you inputted something? Let's take for example the AND gate. The AND gate would only output 1 when two inputs are true/1. This feature of the AND gate can always be useful when you want to check if every input you have are true. Now as a last example, let's see the NOT gate. The NOT gate only takes in one input and will always output the inverse of what you input it. For example, if I input 1/true, it will output 0, and if I input 0, it will output put 1. Now that we've got the logic gates out of the way, let's see some instructions. Now for convenience, I'm going to divide these instructions in three parts. The arithmetic instructions, the stack instructions, and the memory instructions. I'm not going to show you every single instruction there is in assembly, I just want to show you a lot of useful ones that you're going to see a lot, so that you already know them when you need them. Now just before I start, there's still some terminology I need to get out of the way. If you look at this image, you can see there's an add EAX with BX, which will add them together and store the result in EAX. Now what I want you to understand is that the first thing you see, the instruction, is what we call an opcode, and everything that's after this instruction/opcode is the operand. The opcode is the instruction and the operand is the data that you provided. Now let's begin with the arithmetic instructions. The main ones are the add, the sub, the mul, and the dip. One trick to remember these instructions is that they're like mnemonics. Add means addition, sub means subtractions, mul means multiplication, and div means division. Each one of these instructions acts just like add. If you want to subtract EAX with EBX, you will do sub EAX EBX, which will store the result of this subtraction in EAX, the first register or data location that was provided. Now as extra instructions in arithmetic, there's INC and DEC, which means increment and decrement, which you provide one register or location which will be incremented or decremented. Now as for the stack instructions, we have the basic push and pop, which push will push a value to the stack and pop a value from it to a register. But for convenience, we added other instructions to perform these operations in a much performant manner. These instructions are the push A and the pop A instructions. Push A will push all 16 bits registers to the stack, and pop A will pop all 16 bits registers from the stack back to the registers. These instructions can be really useful to save the registers when you need to call a subroutine or function. Now I said they pushed and popped all the 16-bit registers because that's what they do. If you want to push or pop all bigger registers, you'll need to use push AD and pop AD for 32-bit registers. Though in 64-bits, I think these two instructions are banned, so you would have to create a manual macro if you want to still use them or find another way around. Now for the memory instructions, move takes in two operands and copies the second one into the first one. LEA takes two operands as well and is used to copy an address into to a register instead of copying the value at this address. Jump is used to jump into a memory location and continue the execution. The call instruction will first move the return address, which is the current address, to the stack, and set the instruction pointer to the operand, which will allow a subroutine to return to the previous address using the RET instruction. Compare will compare two operands together and set the flag register depending on the result. The test instruction acts a bit like compare but checks more things about your input, so sets more flags. Now that we've seen a lot of instructions, I need to explain what conditional jumps are and how they work. The conditional jumps are just jumps that would jump if certain flags are set to 1 or 0. G, or jump if equal, will jump if a 0 flag is set to 0/false after a compare. And GNE slash jump if not equal will jump if the 0 flag is set to true after a compare. JZ, or jump if 0, will jump if a 0 flag is set to true after test. And JS will jump if SF is set to true. The SF is set to true after a test if the most significant bit in the data is also set. If it's set to true, it means that the value is negative, and otherwise it's positive. Every conditional jump has a jump if not variant. For example, jump if equal has a jump if not equal, jump if 0 has a jump if not 0, and so on and so forth. It's pretty much all the instructions I wanted to show you, and thanks for watching this lecture, and I'll see you in the next one.